Afternoon, folks. Welcome to the Daily Politics. Jeremy Corbyn unveils Labour's election manifesto with the promise of big increases in public spending, tax rises for the better off, and a wave of renationalisation taking various utilities back into public ownership.
Jeremy Corbyn says his programme of hope is fully costed. The Conservatives say Labour's sums don't add up. We'll hear from one of Mr Corbyn's key lieutenants.
Also on today's programme, former Deputy Prime Minister Nick Clegg joins us to discuss secret intelligence, the future of the Lib Dems and political promises.
And why do politicians try so hard to be cool with the kids?
So, after weeks of interviews in which politicians of all stripes have avoided giving answers to questions about policy by saying, you'll have to wait for the manifesto, this week we finally get to see the party's plans in detail. First out of the trap this morning was Labour, with Jeremy Corbyn unveiling his manifesto at an event in Bradford. So what are the headlines from what he calls his programme of hope? Here's Joko.
Yes, a future Labour government would spend a lot more on a wide range of public services. Here are the headlines. An extra £5 billion a year for the NHS in England. £6.3 billion more every year for schools in England. And scrapping university tuition fees and restoring maintenance grants at an estimated annual cost of £11 billion. And Labour would also reverse several welfare cuts. For example, they would scrap the so-called bedroom tax. They would also recruit an extra 10,000 police officers in England and Wales at a cost of £300 million a year. And they would end the current pay cap for public sector workers. So to pay for all that, Labour are also proposing a series of tax rises. Corporation tax will go up to 26% by 2021. It's currently at 19%. There'll also be a tax of up to 0.5% on financial transactions. That's a so-called Robin Hood tax on financial products like bonds and derivatives. And there'll also be a high pay levy. That's a surcharge of up to 5% on companies paying individuals more than £500,000 a year. And income tax will go up to 45% for people earning above £80,000. And people earning above £123,000 will pay a new 50 pence rate of income tax. Another key feature of Labour's manifesto is a radical programme of renationalisation. Labour wants national utilities and services to come back into public ownership. The recent privatisation of the Royal Mail would be reversed, and rail companies would come back into public ownership gradually as franchises expire. Labour would also seek to nationalise the UK's multi-billion pound water companies. And in the energy sector, Labour would seek to bring the national grid under public control and also create regional state-owned energy companies. Let's have a look at some of what Jeremy Corbyn had to say.
Today, we're setting out a manifesto to transform the 21st century in the same way that Harold Wilson in the 1960s sought to transform the 20th century. And it's an absolute pleasure to be here today. This manifesto is a draft for a better future for our country. It's a blueprint of what Britain could be and a pledge of the difference a Labour government can and will make.
Jeremy Corbyn speaking earlier. He's still speaking at the moment, still holding this press conference, launching the manifesto in Bradford. We hope to speak to Andy McDonald. He's a shadow cabinet member about it, but he can't leave that stage until the Labour leader himself is finished. So we're going to have to be patient about that. But the BBC's Chris Mason is with us. He's been watching the manifesto launch. He joins us now. Are there any surprises, or is it much of what we expected because of the leak of last week?
It's pretty similar. So we've been going through it line by line to compare that draft. Thankfully, there's far more people around to do the page turning than there was the other night when I was there on my own flicking through a Word attachment, trying to work out what was in it. Minor tweaks in language. So, for instance, they're promising an expansion on sure start centres, where in the draft they were merely talking about maintaining the existing network. They acknowledge in the actual manifesto that freedom of movement will stop once the UK is outside of the European Union. That wasn't said explicitly in the draft, but broadly speaking, it is the same. And I guess the obvious conclusion, and it is obvious, but it's worth restating, is that for so long, that there was a shtick, wasn't there, in politics, where people would say, oh, what's the point? All the big parties are just the same. Mm. That is just completely unsustainable now as a position with this vast nationalisation programme and a very, very different prospectus put forward by Labour from the Conservatives. The other bit, obviously, Andrew, where the scrutiny is going to come is on the numbers. So Labour have published this document alongside the manifesto on their costings. They say that the tax take would be, I think it's 48.6 billion.
Almost 50 billion, almost they're 50 saying, billion. By, I think, the end of the Parliament, or after 2020 anyway. Yeah. It builds up.
But when you look at the small print and some of the references that they're making around how they're going to make their numbers add up, there's clearly plenty of scope for scrutiny. So I'm seeing already people are looking quite keenly at some of their childcare plans and how they have costed that. And it looks like it's being referenced to a Fabian Society review. Now, whether that would be regarded as standing up to as much scrutiny as the kind of thing that we look for after a budget, where there's references to specific spreadsheets and Treasury documentation or Office of Budget Responsibility numbers, who knows? But there's going to be intense scrutiny, obviously, on how the numbers
add up. The broad thrust, putting the nationalisation costs aside, which is another matter, is that they plan to spend about 50 billion more in current spending in various ways, getting rid of tuition fees, the NHS, and so on. And they plan to raise taxes by 50 billion almost to pay for it. That's the broad thrust.
Yeah. So the broad thrust, around 50 billion in extra taxes. And then on top of that, this idea for significant borrowing. Now, they make the point that borrowing would purely be for what they describe as investment, long-term stuff, as opposed to day-to-day spending that a government does. But they make the argument that that's something that is very much worth doing. It's worth looking as well sometimes about how they divide what they count as something that would be current spending and therefore paid for by tax rises, if it's in addition to what the Conservatives are planning, versus what they say would be justified for borrowing. So, for instance, on the whole business of the NHS, and they were making this argument over the weekend, they say that £10 billion worth of their additional spending on the NHS, which they say would be ring fence for infrastructure and IT, obviously topical in the context of the cyber attack, they say that would be justified coming from borrowing because it would be long-term capital investment.
So that would go onto the borrowing side as well.
Yeah.
But they would also put existing capital spending onto the borrowing side, as I understand it, too, which by 2021 will be 50 billion. They're going to add 25 billion to that, and then perhaps other parts will be added. So they look like they're going to still, by the beginning of the next decade, be borrowing quite a lot, even if it is just for capital spending.
Yeah, so it would seem. And they are pretty proud in arguing that that's worth doing. You know, and again, that emphasises, doesn't it, the massive sort of ideological difference and an outlook difference in terms of how Labour and the Conservatives propose to run the country.
Now, I'm not saying you'll have read every word, obviously, of this manifesto, but is there quite a lot of detail beyond the broad figures in terms of costs and spending and taxes? Is there the detail that Labour were being asked for in terms of costing these spending pledges?
As I say, there is this separate document that they've put out. I suspect, and, you know, we're still in the opening minutes of that being scrutinised, that there'll be quite a few holes that would be pulled into that. First, there's a distinct lack of information about the costing of the nationalisations. But even on the stuff that they do offer a costing for, some of their references on the face of it, and as I say, there's a lot of scrutiny still to come, look like they will be there'll be plenty of unpicking. That will go on there. But on the broader picture, in terms of the promises, what is quite striking is that there's a huge array of, if you like, retail political offers in quite small detail. So this idea of having free Wi-Fi on all trains under a nationalised rail network, I guess the challenge for them, because some of the polling suggests some of their headline offers are quite popular. It's whether or not, I saw this analogy yesterday, which is quite a good one. You know, you can see things that are enticing on a restaurant menu, but if you don't like the look of the restaurant, will you walk through the door? And I guess that's the big political challenge for Labour in the last 3 weeks of the campaign.
Some of these questions we hope to put to Andy McDonald for the Labour Party when the press conference launching the Labour manifesto was over. Listening to us as we were talking to Chris Mason there was Nick Clegg. We've been joined. Welcome to the programme. What do you make of what you've heard so far of the Labour manifesto?
I've just run from an underground station. So all I've heard is this. So
they'd be talking about nothing else.
Even by politician standards, you're now asking me to pronounce with precious little detail. Look, the first thing I'd say from what I hear is, I mean, the good thing about this is this is a manifesto squarely camped now in a completely different ideological space. It is taking a massive gamble that you can squeeze that amount of money from many people who are notoriously mobile and can avoid tax and so on. My time in government, I remember, is it sounds great to say you're going to squeeze the top 5%. It's incredibly difficult to do with that in practice, and it can be a huge inhibition to economic growth and so on. But they're taking a huge gamble that they're not going to kill the economy as they squeeze out money for this fantastic list of wonderful sounding, free everything for everybody. And whilst at the same time remaining, which is the most striking omission, if I understand it correctly, stunningly silent on the biggest economic risk to the British economy of all, which is that we're going to extricate ourselves in the next couple of years from the world's most integrated borderless marketplace, and by the sounds of it, from the customs union as well. During this election campaign, Labour have now sided fully with the Conservative Party to pull us out of the single market. Every authoritative economic analysis says that that will have a detrimental effect on the British economy. So, I don't think there's any dispute that throwing together lots of free Wi-Fi, free this, free that sounds great. It's, as ever with the Labour Party, is it credible? And from what little I've heard, built on what was leaked last week, I don't find it credible at all.
Well, a lot of it was leaked last week, so I'm not sure there's too much that you missed so far.
Well, we got the detailed figures, which we didn't get.
How to pay for it? It's crucial.
Yes. In the leak, and we're going to return to that, as I say. But Chris Mason, we thank you for joining us, and Nick Clegg, good to see you.
Yes, welcome. Now, while we wait for Andy McDonald, that's the Labour spokesperson whom we're going to be interviewing, let's take a look at events across the Atlantic. The White House has denied allegations that President Trump shared highly classified intelligence about Islamic State during a meeting with the Russian foreign minister last week. President Trump held talks with Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov at the White House last Wednesday. But according to a report in the Washington Post today, the president apparently went off script during the meeting and began describing details of an Islamic State terrorist threat related to the use of laptop computers on aircraft. Now, the story claims that the information was highly classified and had actually been provided by a US partner through an intelligence sharing arrangement. Well, President Trump's national security advisor, H.R. McMaster, told reporters that the story was untrue.
At no time were intelligence sources or methods discussed. And the president did not disclose any military operations that were not already publicly known. Two other senior officials who were present, including the Secretary of State, remember the meeting the same way and have said so. Their on-the-record accounts should outweigh those of anonymous sources. And I was in the room. It didn't happen. Thanks, everybody. Thank you.
So, Nick Clegg, Washington is reeling already from the sort of firing of James Comey. What do you think they are doing now as a result of this report in the Washington Post?
Well, from a great distance, what I find so striking about this is it wouldn't, I assume, have found its way into the Washington Post if someone very much, close to the operation of either the security establishment or the operation of the White House itself was not so outraged by what they saw that they chose to leak it. So you've got an administration, and by the sounds of it, in some of the most sensitive parts of that administration, to all intents and purposes, at war with itself. And that is a deeply, what everyone's views about Donald Trump and his ideology, to have an administration which appears so dysfunctional, it's very worrisome, very worrisome. It's clear now that there are parts of the Washington establishment who don't trust their own president with confidential security briefings. That is someone who received confidential security briefings day in, day out for 5 years.
Well,
it is an astonishing thing.
Does it become dysfunctional then? As you say, you were privy in your former life as Deputy Prime Minister to all sorts of sensitive intelligence. And the implication here is that actually this intelligence came from a third party. Could have been Britain, of course, if you perhaps take the Five Eyes countries, of which we are one. It could have been from us, couldn't it?
I have no idea who it came from.
But we would be up there, I suppose, with information from another.
We have a very, very intimate intelligence relationship, not only with the United States, but with Australia, New Zealand and others. And so, of course, yes, you're right, it has a ripple effect on the intelligence community beyond America.
Absolutely.
If you feel that the commander-in-chief, And this is the way it comes across. It may be unfair, but it comes across as if he's a sort of, if he's sort of bragging about the information he has at his disposal to Sergei Lavrov. And you know, that, so that is very, very worrisome for Western intelligence generally.
You say it's worrying for the Washington establishment if parts of the people there don't trust their own president, worrying for the wider intelligence community. What can Donald Trump do now to extricate himself from the sort of growing clamour, if you like, the piling up of claims of his links with Russia?
Well, he's got to come clean, hasn't he? He's got to come clean. He's got to get beyond this.
But can he? I mean, has it gone too far, do you think, in terms of... Because he wanted to sort of end the controversy surrounding it.
And
it
seems
to
me...
Yeah.
Well, I think it was inevitable the moment he fired Comey, the one thing any seasoned Washington, and Andrew is a more seasoned Washington observer than I am, but I mean, it's quite obvious in a millisecond that was only then going to spiral in precisely the direction he was seeking to avoid, because everyone immediately then asks, what's the motive? Why is he doing it? And of course, to all intents and purposes, if you charge around saying everything's fake news, you fire the people who might be treading on your toes. What's the first human
instinct?
He's going to have
the opposite
effect. He's got something to hide. Yeah. Now, I have no idea. Of course, I'm not the faintest idea. I'm not privy to any of this stuff. But he's giving every appearance of being a political leader who is acting out of stress and in a very impetuous way and reacting very, very defensively. And that of course, that's worrisome.
If there is some kind of Russian connection that is yet to come out with Mr. Trump,
I think that would destroy him.
But it's the
and
most
rightly so,
it's the most amazing game of double bluff because he's fired missiles into Syria, blamed the Russians for a lot of what's going on. And yesterday, the US pointed out that the Syrians had built a crematorium where they're burning the bodies of the thousands and thousands of people that they have tortured, then killed, and then said, and the Russians have been complicit in this.
Yeah.
So it's amazing.
Yes. Though what I find interesting is that the pattern of condemnation of Russia did sort of emerge somewhat belatedly. So again, you can't help but feel, why have they come so late in the day to condemning Russia's belligerent behaviour, not just in Syria, but in Ukraine and elsewhere? And of course, again, I'm afraid when these narratives get going, everything reinforces.
Well, that's what I say.
And it reinforces
the
idea
that
they're somehow seeking to cover their tracks. That's the way it looks.
Well, time for our daily quiz, which is not about Russia. The question for today is, which of these election photo opportunities is the odd one out? Is it A, Tim Farron on a hovercraft, B, Tim Farron covered in orange powder, C, Vince Cable on a penny farthing, or D, Nick Clegg high-fiving in Kent? At the end of the show, Nick Clegg will give us the correct answer.
I think there's a Liberal Democrat theme there, anyway.
It looks like.
At least I hope he does, because I don't know what it is. But I've got someone in my ear, I hope will tell me. Now, we're joined from Bradford now, as promised by the Shadow Transport Secretary, Andy MacDonald. Andy MacDonald, welcome to the programme. For about the past month, we've been told you have to wait when we ask where's the money coming from, how'd you cost it? We've been told wait for the manifesto. So the manifesto is published today, lots of detailed costings in it. You want to nationalise the national grid. Its market cap at the moment is about 40 billion. How would you pay for nationalising it?
Well, John McDonnell's going to roll all of those figures out over the next few days in great detail, Andrew. So I won't trespass into his territory, but it does make some sense.
Hold on, Mr. McDonnald. We've had to listen.
Isn't going to be costing us an absolute fortune.
You told us all would be revealed when the manifesto was published. You're now saying we have to wait again? I mean, does the manifesto not tell us how you will pay for the nationalising of the national grid?
Well, it sets out very clearly that there needs to be a rebalance of where the emphasis lies in terms of raising taxes. And this is quite a fundamental change so that it can uplift everybody and not just concentrate on those who are fortunate enough to be extremely rich and done very well. We want to uplift everybody. So that's the thrust of our excellent manifesto, Andrew.
But I've looked at I've managed, it's 128 pages, so I'm not across at all. But I have looked at the funding pages. You want to raise almost 50 billion to spend on various things. But nationalising the national grid's not included in that 50 billion that you're raising. So where will the money come from for that?
Well, I mean, that is just part of a taxation and spend programme, Andrew, and the money will come for that in the fullness of time. I think if you've got the wording in front of you and I haven't, I think you will find that it does say that that is something we want to achieve over time. Okay. So that's not going to be that's the ambition of that manifesto commitment.
What about the water companies, which you also want to nationalise? Thames Water, one of the biggest, that alone is worth about £12 billion. How would you finance that?
Well, again, Andrew, we've set out how we look to the very richest in our society to make a better contribution.
Right.
We're going
but
to be
that's
looking
not for
at
nationalisation, Mr. McDonald.
To take them back up from 19. Well, those are the funds that we will be drawing on to fund the entire programme. And it is about making sure that those corporate entities who are enjoying and will continue to enjoy the lowest corporation tax in the G7 will flourish and continue to flourish, but that they make that proper contribution. We've also got a £36 billion tax gap to fill, which quite frankly has been given little regard by the Tory government. They've been quite content for people to offshore their earnings, be it Uber or who else, because they're part of the same elite and the vested interest that we're so determined to tackle head on. But that's where funding comes from to achieve this very ambitious programme.
But you hope to raise about £6 billion more from raising taxes of the top 5%. But you've already told us that that money will go to finance more money for the NHS, not for the water company purchase or the National Grid or the Royal Mail. So where does the money come for that?
No, you're quite right. What we are saying is we will protect 95% of the working population. They will not see any tax rises, national insurance contribution rises. What we will ask is that the very richest to make a small contribution, and we're asking corporations who benefit so much from trading in our country to again make that small contribution
but
and
you've
still
already
be the lowest
that,
rate in the entire
McDonald.
G7.
But both the money that you hope to raise from increasing corporation tax and the money you hope to raise from raising taxes on the top 5%, that's already spent in your manifesto on things like the NHS, on abolishing tuition fees, on social care, and so on. It's not being spent on what I'm asking you about, which is the cost of nationalisation.
Andrew, it's hot off the presses. It was published at 11 o'clock. Now, John McDonnell
is going
to be setting
cabinet.
That programme out in very great detail, in further detail, Andrew. And I'm not going to trespass into his territory when he's going to give you that clarity that you will have in abundance.
Have you read the manifesto,
talk to me
Mr.
about,
McDonnell?
I have indeed. I've had I was at the Clause 5 meeting when we looked at the draft that that we agreed on on that day. And of course, this is the published format that I looked at this morning.
Right. Okay, good. So if you've read it, which, as I say, I've not yet had the privilege of doing all of that, but if you've read it, what does the manifesto say about financing the nationalisation of National Grid, the water companies, and the Royal Mail?
Well, as I've said, Andrew, we've set out that programme. We've told you very clearly where monies are coming from.
So where is it coming
terms
from?
Of the
tell me again.
Raising
assume I'm a slow learner. Tell me again.
Well, Andrew, I've said to you know, let John McDonnell roll that out in very great detail.
But is it in the manifesto?
It's absolutely hot off the presses. And my understanding is it's there, but you know, we're trying to keep this one under wraps until about 11:15, and as you say, it's quite a weighty tome. So you know, if you give me a chance, I'll have a good look at it.
You're going to increase the bank levy. You're going to increase corporation tax by a third. You're going to increase capital gains tax. You're going to introduce a financial transactions tax. You're going to put a cap on top pay. You're going to have higher taxes for those earning over 80,000 a year. You're going to put a levy on companies that pay high salaries. What allowances have you made by doing all that, that the behaviour and companies of companies and people will change? and you won't get the money you think.
Well, I think those are modest and reasonable proposals, and it makes all the sense in the world to me that when people are trading with shares, then they're at 0.5%. If they're then getting into the trading on derivatives, that there should be some transaction from that, when a cost of that, when they're gambling on the increase or decrease in those shares. It's a financially profitable activity.
What if they go abroad?
Well, I mean, individuals or corporations?
Both.
I mean, you're talking about people who... some people may go off to buy an island in the Caribbean, but
they may just go to Switzerland or Brussels or Luxembourg.
I'm absolutely convinced that there's that patriotic commitment to our country, and these are modest contributions that we're asking for. You've got to remember that the corporation tax was at 28%. I mean, we're talking now of getting it all the way down to 17%, and Lord alone knows what's going to happen if ultimately a Conservative government that's re-elected takes us down to 12%. What's going to happen then to our National Health Service and our schools and our social care? Okay. These are the things that are crucially important to everyday people, ordinary people. These are their priorities. And you've got to have a tax base, a reasonably structured tax base, that makes sure that those provisions are made for them.
Now, you are also got a lot of money that you want to borrow to spend on what's generally called infrastructure investment. But you will not be allowed to bid for that infrastructure investment if the senior management is paid 20 times more than the lowest paid worker. Are you aware of any infrastructure companies, British or foreign, where the ratio is 20 to 1 or below? Any?
Well, Andrew, I can't give you a direct response to that. But what I can tell you is I think it's eminently reasonable that there be some relationship between those people who are working hard every day, creating that wealth, and the individual who's at the top of that organisation. Pay scales have got out of hand, and they're at ridiculously comparative rates between ordinary people who are going about their day and creating the wealth for that company. It's only right and proper that there should be a relationship between the two.
Right.
So I don't anticipate that that's going to impinge.
But
I think it's entirely right.
No, if you look at the world,
are going to want to invest in our country, that they make sure that they are abiding by our systems and they make their proper contribution.
What happens if the infrastructure companies say, we're not going to do that? We're just not going to bid for these British infrastructure contracts. The world is full of infrastructure contracts. We are not going to cut the salaries of our senior management to suit a Labour government. What do you do then? How do you build the new railways and the roads and so on? How do you do it?
The problem that we've had in this country for many years is that people coming to invest have found our infrastructure woefully inadequate. And what we've laid out is our commitment to invest in our infrastructure to make sure that we've got our transport infrastructure.
I understand
that
that's not my point. My point is that the condition you're making could lead to an infrastructure strike that the companies won't bid.
No. I'm not convinced that that's the case at all, Andrew. I think that these companies will want to invest in our country. They know that they've got a government who wants to work with them, but there's got to be some sense prevails in terms of the excesses that are drawn out of the system. And I certainly don't think that a government of the United Kingdom should be party to simply pouring money into the coffers of a tiny minority. These investment strategies have got to be for the benefit of the entire country, not for a handful of individuals. That's just obscene. And we've got to make sure that the entire nation benefits, not just a few.
All right, Andy McDonald, lots more to talk about, but we'll need to do it in the days and weeks ahead before June the 8th. Thanks for joining us from the Labour Manifesto launch.
Many thanks.
Well, following that, we're going to get a roundup of all the other election campaign news, because here's our Emma. Emma.
Thanks, Joe. Well, it's been an action-packed 24 hours of campaigning. And if I had one piece of advice for politicians today, it would be do your homework on the figures, especially before going on the radio. When will they learn? Well, that's a clue as to what's coming up. And we've also had some furry friends making an appearance on the campaign trail. And I don't just mean the candidates. So sit back and enjoy today's campaign roundup.
That awkward moment when an unwanted guest gate crashes your party. During Theresa May's ITV Facebook Live, look who popped up.
Surprisingly, I've got a question in from Jeremy Corbyn of Islington.
He's with the longest question ever.
House building is at its lowest. Do you not think the British people deserve to see...
Thanks for coming, JC.
I and he take questions directly from the voters.
And if the government can do sweetheart deals for Surrey, well, how about making us all...
Meanwhile, Jeremy Corbyn was reminding Labour voters in West Yorkshire of that alleged Tory deal for Surrey County Council.
Although I do realise for Tory ministers, Surrey is the hardest word.
Diane Abbott isn't the only one struggling with her sums.
What is Britain's also, deficit at the moment, Mr.
If Biden? If I can say to you...
Labour's John McDonnell was accused of Googling the deficit figure while being questioned on Radio 4 this morning.
Did somebody pass you a piece of paper? What is our deficit at the moment?
Not at all.
It just sounds like there was a bit of paper being it's, handed
no,
across
No, not at all.
What is our deficit at the moment,
The deficit
Mr.
at the moment is £68 to £70 billion.
The Shadow Chancellor appeared to get it wrong by £18 billion, quoting the figure given on Wikipedia rather than the correct figure of £52 billion. Tim Farron addressed a business breakfast in Bath. The Lib Dems want to create a start-up allowance to help budding entrepreneurs.
I am going to do an uncharacteristic thing and shut up and listen. There you are.
And who needs a battle bus for getting about? And Nicola Soames isn't the only one with a four-legged friend. But today's winning partnership...
So there you go. What will our colourful cast get up to next day? But I can assure you, Andrew, whatever it is, we'll be watching and we'll bring you the best bits. More tomorrow.
I've no doubt about that. And throughout the campaign, we're taking the Daily Politics mood box around the country to test, yep, the mood of the public. Today, Ellie is in Edinburgh. At least I hope she's in Edinburgh.
She's being very quiet.
But lines to Edinburgh are down. So why don't we just go straight into the mood box itself? Cutting Ellie out, I'm afraid.
I need a little time to think it over.
Never trust them. They never do.
Anyone in particular or all of them?
No, they all make promises they don't keep eventually.
Do you trust the political parties to stick to their manifestos?
Well, if it's a straight yes or no, I think the answer probably has to be no.
It's partly an individual loss of integrity for people, and partly the whole system is set up that, you know, people have to compromise and lie in order to get votes, and they don't carry it through.
I think I would only trust SNP, honestly. I think Sturgeon comes through as truthful.
Manifestos, they don't ever seem to really come to fruition in the way that they're supposed to.
I feel a bit strange answering this question.
I would not trust SNP because, well, they've proven that they don't stick to their manifesto. Lib Dems, I think, would, but they're not going to get in.
Promises, promises turn to dust. Trust into mistrust.
Do you think you could trust the political parties to keep their word after the manifesto?
Yes, definitely not.
Oh, look, that looks like a trolley load of empty promises.
Well, yes, I suppose it would be, really. No, I don't. I think even the sincerest parties that might actually want to stick to their policies find that once they get in there that they can't.
I think if people can actually stick with the idea of their promises and maybe some of the detail might have to change, then that's fair enough. That's being practical about things because things change.
Usually when they say things like...
I am going to fix the problems in the health service or money or something like this, usually it doesn't always get worse, but it doesn't usually get better.
Any lasting relationship needs trust, and when the political parties come wooing voters in this marginal seat, they'll have their work cut out, because no, the majority don't think that the parties stick to their manifestos after elections. So there you go. Thank you, Edinburgh South.
Gentlemen. That was one Ellie recorded earlier. We couldn't get to her live in Edinburgh, but that was there. Trust and honesty. You, of course, have been haunted by the tuition fees business. I don't want to go into that. But is it? Are people now less trusting in politicians, do you think?
I don't know. I should think they've always been distrusting.
They've always been skeptical, I think.
Of rulers, haven't they? Has it got worse? Maybe it has. Maybe it has. I don't know. Right. I mean, look, it's a dilemma I've grappled with myself, and I don't have a perfect answer, because there is always a collision between what you ideally want to do in life and what reality allows you to do, not just in politics, but in life generally. And, you know, the idea that every time a politician needs to make a compromise with reality, particularly as events intrude, that they're shouted down as somehow, you know, being morally callow and betray. I mean, that's a problem, because with each sort of, with each turn of the wheel, even where sort of innocent collisions, if I can put it like that, happen, cynicism just increases. Of course, what is out of order, of course, is if people, you know, knowingly say something which they have sort of deliberately planned to not do. I mean, I found myself, I won't rake over it, but in the invidious position of, you know, no money, not in charge, and so on and so forth. But I wonder whether politicians need to do more to be more upfront with people that manifestos, and we shouldn't pretend that they're tablets of stone. They're not, because life changes, banking crises happen, wars happen, all sorts of things happen. So I don't know. Maybe we also need to, particularly at this breathless phase of an election campaign, be maybe more grown up, but we talk about what we can and can't do.
Now, you've said that the Leave side of last year's referendum campaign never made it clear that we have to leave the membership of the single market. You said that. And when you were on the Sunday Politics, we ran a bit of tape and gate track. I want to run it again just to see if your reaction's still the same, because we looked at what people had said on the Leave and Remain side about the single market. Let's just refresh our memories.
The British public would be voting, if we leave, would be to leave the EU and leave the single market.
Should we come out the single market?
I think that is almost certainly would be the case, yes.
Do you want us to stay inside the single market, yes or no?
No, we should be outside the single market.
I had Michael Gove in that chair and I said, after Brexit, will we be in the European single market, yes or no? And he said, no.
And he was right.
So we won't be in the European single
market. Yeah, absolutely.
We'd be out of the single market. That's the reality. Britain would be quitting the single market.
You see, people watch, when I showed that to you last time, you said, oh, these are just sound bites.
But I'll tell you why I still disagree with you, because we didn't receive... See, I'm afraid I think there is. I mean, you and I are just going to carry on disagreeing.
No, I'm not disagreeing. People will think when they see that, actually, they did make it pretty clear we'd leave.
But no one received in the country, you didn't, I didn't, no one watching this, received a manifesto from the Brexit campaign saying, this is the kind of Brexit that we propose to you. We didn't have one with Kate Hoey, Nigel Farage, Boris Johnson, Michael Gove on a cross-party basis saying, we want to leave and we want to leave on this basis. And by the way, that's why you were quite rightly asking them in interviews and television studios, because, of course, prior to that, people like Owen Paterson had said it would be mad to leave the single market. Nigel Farage and Dan Hannan had advocated the Norwegian approach, which retains our membership of the single market. In other words, it was debatable. I agree that we got those answers. I could hear them myself. But it was never put to the British people in a clear way. And so I'm afraid I still can't accept that a number of individual statements under pressure in a sort of question and answer session in a television studio constitutes an open proposition to the British people about what Brexit means in practice.
But you didn't seem to be in much doubt either that we'd be leaving the single market if we voted to leave. I mean, this is what you said at an Intelligence Squared debate. Let's see this.
To be fair, the Brexit campaign have, I think, come clean now and said, we dislike it so much we actually want to tear up Margaret Thatcher's single European Act. We don't want to have anything to do with a single market either. I think that is a devastatingly self-harming thing to do economically, and I wouldn't want it on my conscience.
So even you were clear. Said they'd made it clear that they wanted to tear up the single market arrangement.
But the problem is, you are taking a number of statements from politicians on rival points of the debate in the final stage of the referendum, and I think translate or describing that as an open proposition to the British people in the most important referendum in our lifetime. What I was reacting to was that under pressure in interviews, some Brexiteers, not all of them, crucially, not all of them, were saying that they felt that this meant we would leave the single market. The British people never had a clear proposition put to them as one on a cross-party basis by the Brexit campaign and what it meant. And by the way, invoking what David Cameron and George Osborne said is the oddest thing of all, is because you're having you're having the winning side of a referendum quoting the words of the losing side of the referendum for what they themselves were not clear about.
I mean, if the British people watch and David Cameron says we'd have to leave the single market. George Osborne said we'd have to leave. Michael Gove said we'd have to leave. Andrea Leadsom said we'd have to leave. Boris Johnson said. Nick Clegg said it's clear we'd have to leave. What's your argument?
Maybe we're going to make finally some progress. Guess what? People don't watch. They don't watch the interviews between you and me. They don't watch Andrew Marr on Sunday morning all the time. Actually, what you do in a referendum...
They don't read manifestos either.
We've got it today, a very important moment. The principal party of opposition is publishing a manifesto, and you quite rightly are scrutinising that manifesto because you accept it is a convention in a democracy that the two sides or multiple sides in a debate put forward a coherent plan for what they want to do. That did not happen in the run-up to the referendum. In fact, what we did know, the one thing we knew, which people did take notice of, which was not snatched conversations in television studios, was a socking great big lie on the side of a bus of 350
million... That's another issue, and we went through them with that. But my simple point on this is that even you were clear that if we voted to leave, we left membership of the single market.
What you saw me clipped, let's not mistranslate things, was I was saying that some Brexiteers had admitted that...
No, the Brexit campaign, you said, had come clean.
Well, there was no manifesto from the Brexit campaign. I still don't know. It is quite remarkable, almost a year since the referendum. I still don't know, because I still can't get a clear answer, either from the government or indeed from Brexiteers and the Labour Party and elsewhere, what they want to do in the customs union, what they mean by a free trade agreement, which apparently now, we've been told since the referendum, will deliver us miraculously the exact same benefits, in the words of David Davis, as being inside the single market. I think all of this is specious nonsense.
Right,
if I get worked up about it, it's only because, I'll tell you why, I don't think they ever came clean with the British people.
Well, you just said they had come clean, actually, but never mind. I mean,
In the form in which the mass of people who voted could actually, you know, be fairly described as being informed by a cross-party campaign group.
All right. But you're losing the argument, aren't you? The latest YouGov poll now has 68% of people supporting Brexit. Even the so-called re-leavers, people who voted to remain, but now just think you should get on with it. You're in a minority now.
Oh, no, I totally accept that. This is wholly predictable that even people who voted remain, there'll be lots of people, and I come across them a lot. It's a very pragmatic British attitude. They sort of say, come on. Move along.
We didn't like it, but let's do it.
No, absolutely. And I totally understand that. By the way, those are exactly the same people who may well, in the next year or two, change their minds when they feel that the reality of Brexit is not all that it's cracked up to be. But of course, I would fully expect that some, maybe many Remain voters who don't feel as strongly about it as others, sort of say, well, come on, we've had that argument, let's move on. No, I think that's not...
Let me play one other clip. It doesn't involve you. It's your... I think he's now, again, your Treasury spokesman, certainly your colleague in government, Vince Cable. Let's have a look at this.
How many people would this give a pay rise to?
Well, this is across the public sector, you know, the military, civilians...
And how many people is that?
Well, we're talking, you know... Probably millions, actually, but the core public sector, you know, teachers, nurses, public sector workers. No, we're not making exceptions.
So about 1 million people, 5 million people?
It's probably about a couple, I would have thought, yeah.
A couple of million, so yeah, 2 million people?
Roughly, yeah.
And so how much would that cost if you were
Well, we're talking about 1.4 billion in the first year, and subsequently, obviously, it will depend on the rate of inflation.
OK. So, according to the latest statistics, the total number of public sector workers as of December last year was 5.4 million people.
Right.
Did you ever think you'd call him Vince Cable? Trained economist, graduated from Cambridge, PhD from the University of Glasgow, would have a Diane Abbott moment?
Listen, I could easily have a Diane Abbott moment.
I think we could all have that.
Exactly, because, I mean, look, everyone's rushing from...
He should just have said, yeah, I haven't got the figures. Right,
I'm sure he could have. Funnily enough, I actually think, because I thought I'd better...
What number did you think?
...quickly myself. No, I mean, I'm really honest with you. I thought, I probably wouldn't have better. I think it's actually 5.4 in the whole of the UK, whereas the...
For public sector, that's
right. Yeah, whereas 4.5 in England, which is what the policy, I think, would apply to. But you know, if you include the devolved administrations, it is indeed 5.5. Look, Vince is a great guy. He's a good, accomplished economist. But even Vince,
that's my point.
People with an encyclopedic brain like Vince do not have all the statistics.
We're all vulnerable.
Yeah, we are. Oh, indeed we are, yes.
There for the grace of God go I. Indeed. And on that, it's not just Labour who are publishing their manifesto today. This is the week of manifestos for many of the parties. Plaid Cymru have also been busy setting out their pitch to the public with a promise to provide a strong voice for Wales. Here's the party leader, Leanne Wood.
The choice is not between the Conservatives and Labour. The choice is whether we want to put Wales on the political landscape. The choice is whether we keep voting for London-based parties or whether we vote for ourselves, for our own party, for a party which is based in Wales and whose only loyalty is to the people who live here.
Leanne Wood. Well, the party's finance spokesman, Adam Price, joins us live from Cardiff. Adam, welcome back to the Daily Politics. Your party opposed Brexit and, as you know, 52% of Wales voted to leave. Is the fact that you are trying to position yourselves as the party who will put Wales at the heart of Brexit negotiations just a case of a little too late? A little too late?
Well, I think the arguments of the past should be left where they are in the past. You know, we've got to look to the future now. We are coming out of the European Union, and we have to ensure that it's the best Brexit possible for the Welsh economy. You know, there are some specific risks because of the structure of our economy, manufacturing much bigger, farming much bigger. But there are also some opportunities there which are not often talked about. For example, coming out of the EU, we now have the ability to set regional or subnational rates for different taxes like VAT. We could have a lower VAT rate, for example, to help our tourism sector. We could do the same also for corporation taxes, have a variable corporation tax rate reflecting the lower levels of economic prosperity at the moment in places like Wales. That would give us a competitive advantage which would draw businesses to Wales and also help those that are already here to grow more effectively.
But you want the government to match every penny of EU funding that Wales received. What happens if they don't?
Well, you know, it goes back to the earlier conversation, isn't it? I'm old-fashioned when it comes to promises made by politicians to the public.
You think they should keep them?
I think they should keep them. Because otherwise, you know, it started in the Iraq war, didn't it? For me, certainly, the lies that happened then, that left a shadow. And, you know, it remains reflected there in the low levels of trust that we have in our democratic system.
Right.
So let's institute a new rule. If you make a promise, you keep to it. We all remember the bus. I mean, if you tot up the figure proportionally, Wales, that should mean 17 million a week. And of course, we were also promised that we wouldn't lose a single penny of the EU money that we get for our farmers and for our regional development. You put the two together, Joe, actually, that's 30 million a week. By my calculation, that's a district general hospital built in Wales with the money that we were promised probably every month.
So why aren't more people listening to that message? If you're putting forward such a comprehensive argument for Wales and for funding for Wales, why aren't you gaining more votes from Labour, for example? I mean, you have three MPs in the by-election in Ogmore, I understand, last year. You came third behind UKIP. Your message is falling on deaf ears.
But in the local elections, I mean, the biggest opinion poll that we could have this close to a general election, we almost had our best ever result in 92 years of fighting
and the
elections.
The Tories gained 80 seats.
So I think it's clear in the conversations that I am having, people are listening, particularly disaffected Labour voters, but also people in other parties as well. They're looking for new leadership. They're looking for a new voice. You know, Wales isn't on the political radar at the moment. We've been a tiny blip in terms of the priorities.
Isn't that down
for
to you?
Those people down in Westminster and indeed in the streets of Whitehall as well. We've got got to reverse that. You know, people actually sit up and listen in the corridors of power when Scotland is mentioned. Why? Because people vote SNP. Northern Ireland is on the radar. Gibraltar is more talked about at the moment than Wales. And the only way we can turn that around is if we all vote collectively as a nation for the Party of Wales on June the 8th.
How strong a part does Welsh independence play in your manifesto?
Sorry, Joe, could you just repeat that?
Yes, of course. How strong a part does Welsh independence play in your manifesto?
Well, it's a long-term dream for a nation. It's there in the foreword, but, you know, right. We're not at the...
But it's a pretty minor part.
Yeah, we're not at the independence threshold. Let's be realistic. You know, we are 30% poorer than the rest of the UK. And that's been a story of decline under Labour and Conservative governments. You can't go from that position to being self-reliant economically by the flick of a switch. You know, what we're asking for is to be given the tools, those new tools that we can have now as a result of Brexit, giving actually preferment to local firms in terms of public procurement that would help boost our local economy as well. Give us the tools. We're not asking for charity, Joe. We're asking for help to help ourselves.
All right. Adam Price, thank you very much.
Now, let's take a look at the platform of another party standing in the general election, the Liberal Party, not to be confused with the Liberal Democrats. Pay attention now. The Liberal Party traces its roots back to 1859, but was founded in its current form in 1989 by those opposed to the creation of the Liberal Democrats. It's got around 2,500 Twitter followers, not quite up with Kardashian there, and campaigns for every citizen to possess liberty, property and security. The party seeks withdrawal from the European Union and campaigned for a leave vote in last year's referendum. It supports spending 0.7% of national income on overseas aid and would negotiate the cancellation of third world debt. It also calls for the wider use of Esperanto as a language for all governments and people who wish to use it. So let's now go and speak to the man who represents the Liberal Party. Steve Radford joins us now. Steve Radford, thank you for that. When we think of Liberal Party, we tend to think of the 19th century, of the Liberal Party of Gladstone, which came out of the Whigs. What are the historic and intellectual antecedents for your Liberal Party?
Well, I think it's a lot of the Gladstone principles of free trade, simplified taxation, encouraging business are as true and valid and useful for the United Kingdom looking ahead today as it was so many years ago.
Now, you call yourselves the real Liberals and not the Lib Dems. Why aren't the Liberal Democrats, which you can draw a line from them back to Mr. Gladstone as well, why aren't they real Liberals?
Well, I think there's a mixed bag, and I think there's some colleagues in the Liberal Democrats who I would feel comfortably Liberals. There's others who are openly in this election campaigning on the basis they want a new centre party that's not particularly liberal, probably have Tony Blair as its leader, and they just want centre politics and pro-European centralisation. And I think if we be quite blunt about it, the main difference between the Liberal Party and the Liberal Democrats, the Liberal Party is looking to Britain being a global player, a sovereign country looking out to the world, whilst the Liberal Democrats are really hankering back to sabotage Brexit, and they want a more centralised Europe and would have signed up for the euro and losing control of our economy even more than currently. So there's a clear watershed.
OK, well, as you know, we've got Nick Clegg, former leader of the Liberal Democrats here. What do you say to that?
Well, I think... Is it Steve, is it?
Yes, Steve.
I think Steve should join the Conservatives. I mean, I don't see that. I'm not saying that facetiously. Everything he said is mainstream Conservative thinking, out of the European Union, low tax, pro-enterprise, anti-state. I mean, it's a perfectly venerable tradition in British politics. It's not one I fully share, obviously, but it's clearly representing the Conservative Party. So I don't quite know why Steve is spending all his time not giving way to his inner Conservative.
It's a good question, Steve Radford. What's the answer?
Because on social policies, the Liberal Party is in favour of redistribution of wealth to help the lower paid, which is not a Conservative agenda that's being delivered. And Nick knows that. There's some things where we're going to agree and there's some things we're going to disagree on. I personally think one of the good positive things with the Lib Dem influence the last coalition was raising tax thresholds and trying to simplify the taxation. I would like to see that go further. I'd like us to have more help for the low paid. And unlike the Liberal Democrats, we've got a policy on taxing inheritances, which are are a source of great inequality in British society and using that to pay for the tuition fees that he said he was going to abolish. So there are differences where I agree with the Lib Dems, and there's differences and similarities where I agree with the Conservatives. But it doesn't stop me being a Liberal and doesn't mean I'm going to join Tony Blair's Centre Party.
And how would you tax inheritance?
Well, I think you could get rid of all the exemptions over virtually most of the people who inherit wealth absolutely pay no tax at all. If we got rid of the exemptions, we could apply a modest rate of inheritance tax, and then we could fund start-up business grants, and we could fund tuition fees. We could use the capital of one generation.
Well, you couldn't fund tuition fees out of changes to the inheritance tax. It doesn't bring that much in.
You look at the absolute substantial amount of monies that don't pay any inheritance at all. I think it would make a great step towards funding tuition fees, or at least modifying them as they are.
All right, Steve Radford of the Liberal Party from Merseyside. We'll leave it there. Thank you.
Now, one of our favourite campaign pastimes, and there are a few, is watching our politicians desperately trying to be cool. Thankless task. Have a look at these. Chuka Amuna was down with the dab, as they say, at a school in Streatham. We've all done that on this show. You might remember Tom Watson recently performed this dance move in the Commons. And Jeremy Corbyn had a laid-back chill-out at the weekend with rapper JME. What do you mean? Never heard of him. But as ever, the French had to get one up on us. Have a look at France's new president, Emmanuel Macron, attempting and succeeding at a craze called the bottle flip.
Voilà.
Nick, when we come. I'm just handing Nick the prop for the next bit of the show. Do you know what these are?
Yes, my 8-year-old loves this.
Ah, see,
they've got one with the lights light up.
Oh, so there are different types.
Oh, lots of different types.
The lights would be great.
Andrew, I'm going to give you this one.
Oh, thank you very much.
Because it's the one that doesn't work very well, because I've tried them all.
And your eyes are very sticky.
It is very sticky, your one. So have you started using it?
It's quite addictive.
It is quite addictive.
It's quite addictive.
You know, you might be fidget spinners.
Fidget spinners, that's right.
So,
but I've also read that the man who invented this, and they are being sold like hotcakes around the world, isn't getting a penny for it.
Isn't getting a penny for it?
He didn't secure the copy.
Oh, no, he didn't secure the copy. Well, that's very unfortunate, because they were selling them out. So it was selling them out. So can you do tricks with them?
No.
Come on, you've got to try. You've got to balance it on your finger.
Oh, right, go on.
You've got to balance it. No, balance it on the finger like this, or one, and try and pop it onto the next one, because I can't do it either.
I would do it, but mine doesn't work.
That's an excuse. You should be able to do it. Is it ever worth a politician trying to be cool?
Yes, because otherwise it wouldn't give you hours of amusement watching us fail.
Good answer.
It's essential to provide entertainment.
And we're very grateful.
So do you think
it's working.
Do you think Emmanuel Macron is succeeding so far? He does.
Well, the person, of course, who's now held to be the coolest of the cool, of course, is Justin Trudeau, who has this.
Yes.
And Obama. Obama was quite cool.
Yeah, Obama. But I mean, Trudeau, I think, is considered to be.
He is.
Now, listen, there's just time before we go to find out the answer to our quiz. I'm going to keep this one. Do you remember the question? Which of these, Nick Clegg, election-related photos is the odd one out? A, Tim Farron on a hovercraft. B, Tim Farron covered in powder. C, Vince Cable on a penny farthing. Or D, you, Nick Clegg, high-fiving.
Yes, it's me.
Yes, and why is that?
Because we never released the video which that was for.
Is that right?
For very good reason.
I know, we wanted to know what the reason was.
Because it was just cringingly embarrassing.
That's a good reason. I'll buy that. That's it for today. We'll be back with another Daily Politics election special at noon tomorrow.
Yes, make sure you join us all then. We'll have all the latest from the campaign trail. But from all of us here, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Richard.